أشهد أن محمد عبده ورسوله صلوات الله وسلامه عليه أما بعد. As we anticipate the advent inshallah of the blessed month of Ramadan, I want to make this khutbah an issue that is connected to Ramadan, but in fact it is more important than Ramadan, and it gives an indication of the reality of the condition of the Muslims today. And it be said about Ramadan and fasting, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, رُبَّ صَائِمٍ لَيْسَ لَهُ مِنْ صِيَامِهِ إِلَّا الْجُوعُ وَالْعَطِشُ. It may be that a person, he's fasting, but he doesn't get any benefit from his fast except that he makes himself hungry and he makes himself thirsty. There are a number of ayat in the Quran, that Allah Ta'ala has warned the Muslim of being like the people from Ahl al-Kitab and being like the Mushrikeen of Quraysh. People who do a lot of deeds and they make a lot of efforts. In Yawm al-Qiyamah, their deeds and efforts are going to come with no benefit. Maybe 25 ayat, like the statement of Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala, وَقَدِّمْنَا إِلَى مَا عَمِلُوا فَجَعَلْنَهُ هَبَاءً مَنْثُورًا. Yawm al-Qiyamah, we're going to bring their deeds, fasting, salat, whatever. We're going to bring their deeds, and we're going to make their deeds like scattered particles. They won't be of any benefit, any avail. Allah mentioned in the Quran about the Kufar, Mecca, and Quraysh. They used to worship Allah at the Kaaba. وَمَا كَانَ صَلَاتُهُمْ عِنْدَ الْبَيْتِ إِلَّا مُكَاءٌ وَتَصْدِيَةٌ. The salat of Quraysh, Kufar, Quraysh, their salat was nothing but clapping hands and whistling. And that's because they were making shit with Allah. So a person can do a deed, fasting or whatever, he's doing a deed. Whatever the deed comes to Jum'ah, he's doing a deed. But because he's doing it the wrong way, or because he has a bad intention, or because some other external issues are happening, his deeds won't be given to him any rewards. So the person may fast, and he doesn't get any benefit from fasting except that he made himself hungry and thirsty. Now from those people who fast every year, and I swear by Allah, wallahi, billahi, tawahi, there is no fast for the person who doesn't pray. The person who doesn't pray, his Islam is in jeopardy. There's a big question mark, is he a Muslim, is she a Muslim? And unfortunately, although I don't know any of you, the majority of the people connected to you, they don't pray. That's the condition of our ummah. Our relatives, our friends, our neighbors, our wives, relatives, we just don't pray. So it's no strange phenomenon, the situation in Iraq, Philistine, Kashmir, Afghanistan, and the rest of the Muslim world. How does Allah, and why would Allah help an individual who doesn't pray? Why would Allah, how would Allah help a family that doesn't pray? Help a community that doesn't pray? Help a group of people that don't pray? So what I want to do here today, inshallah ta'ala, is I want to show you how the salat was during the time of the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the salaf of this ummah. So the khutbah is about what? The khutbah is not about putting anyone down. The khutbah is about how the companions used to look at this salat and how the Muslims look at the salat today. That's what the khutbah is about. First of all, concerning the salat, the Nabi told us sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, أَوَّلُ مَا يُحَاسَبُ بِهِ الْعَدُّ مِنْ أَعْمَالِهِ يَوْمُ الْقِيَامَةِ الصَّلَاةِ. The very first thing that Allah is going to ask the slave about Yawmul Qiyamah is about his prayer. He stands before Allah, the very first thing he's going to be asked about is his prayer. That alone shows the importance and the significance of the salat in the life of the Muslim. If he's going to be raised up Yawmul Qiyamah and he believes in Yawmul Qiyamah, the very first question is, how was your prayer? Did you pray it on time? Did you pray it correctly? Did you pray it with ikhlas and khushur in the way it was supposed to be prayed? The Nabi told the people sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, As-salat khayrul mawdu' فَمَنْ اسْتَطَاعَ أَنْ يَسْتَكْفِرْ فَلْيَسْتَكْفِرْ. The salat is the best thing, it's the best subject. So whoever has the ability to make more prayer, let him make more prayer. So the companions, after praying Salatul Fajr, they will come to the masjid after the sun went up, they leave. Go home, take a ghusl, and come back. There were people in the masjid praying two raka, until the imam came out. And each one of those two raka, it has its virtues. It has its place in the sunnah. Whoever has the ability to do a lot of prayer, like in Taraweeh, then do a lot of prayer, like the sunnah prayer other than that. So again, let us take a look. How was this prayer during the time of the companions, and how is it during the time that we live in right now? There was a student from the companions, his name is Abdullah ibn Shaqiq al-Uqayli. He was from the Tabi'een and from the ulama of the Tabi'een, taught by a number of companions. قال ما كان أصحاب النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يرون شيء من الأعمال تركه كفرا غير الصلاة. The companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they did not look at and they did not consider the abandonment of any action as kufr other than the salah. If a lady became a Muslim and she didn't wear hijab, the companions would say, maybe she's a new Muslim, maybe she's a slave. They gave her excuses. If a person during the time of Abu Bakr and Uthman and Ali, if an individual didn't give zakah, the companions, if they found out, they said, maybe he's poor, he's miskin, fiqir, doesn't have to give zakah. If a person they knew he wasn't fasting, they said, maybe he's a traveler, maybe he's sick, maybe something is wrong. If he didn't make hajj, the companions made excuses. Maybe he doesn't have the money. Maybe he can't go because he has to stay with his mother and his father. But if the companions knew this person doesn't pray, the companion said he's a kafir. The companion said he's a kafir. And that's because the Nabi told us sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and told them, Al-ahdu alladhi baynana wa baynahum as-salah. Man tarakaha faqad kafara. The difference between us, the people in this room, the people of Islam, the difference between us and these non-Muslims, Sikh, Hindu, Jew, Christian, agnostic, atheist, the difference between us and them, the Nabi said, is salah. Whoever leaves it is a kafir. That's how the companions used to look at the salah. As the one action, if you left it, you were kafir billah. In addition to that, there's another tabi'i. And the khutbah is about how the companions used to look at the salah. This man, his name is Ibrahim al-Nakhai. Ibrahim al-Nakhai, he was taught by Abdullah ibn Mas'ud and a number of tabi'in, a number of companions. He said about those people during that time, كانوا إذا أتوا الرجل ليأخذوا عنه العلم نظروا إلى صلاته وصمته وهديه. In the past, Ibrahim al-Nakhai said, if the people came to learn knowledge, to get benefit, they heard there's a sheikh who's teaching. There's someone who wants to teach the Quran, the Arabic, the Hadith, fiqh. He wants to give the khutbah. They said, if they went to get knowledge for someone, they would not sit and take knowledge from him until first they looked at how did he pray. And they looked at his hadith, how he was. Did he drink with his right hand or did he drink with his left hand? Did he give with his left hand? Did he take with his left hand? And they used to look at his general behavior. So the very first thing they used to look at before they would allow a man to give the khutbah, before they would take knowledge from a man, they would look at his prayer. Was he one of those people who prayed very quickly? He's looking around like this, because if they saw someone looking around in salah, they'll say, he's not qualified to teach. He's not qualified to be paid attention to. He's not qualified to give the khutbah. The Nabi, he says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, إِنَّ أَسْرَقَ الرَّجُلُ الَّذِي يَسْرَقُ مِنْ صَلَاتِهِ لَا يَتِمُّ رُكُوعَهَا وَلَا سَجُودَهَا. The biggest thief, the biggest harami, the biggest thief is the one who steals from his prayer. He doesn't give the ruku' its haq. He doesn't give the sajda its haq. He just prays very quickly, like a chicken, just to get it done. So those people in the past, Ikhwani, they will look. When the man prayed, I want to take knowledge from him. Does he pray towards a sutra? Does he do rafa'i yadayn? How does he read? How does he move? If they saw that the person was following what the Nabi said about this important issue, then they would say, okay, now I'm going to take knowledge from him. That's how the people were in the past. Unfortunately today, the condition of the people today. Someone wants to marry my sister. Someone wants to marry my daughter. Your sister, your daughter, you're the wali. He comes and you do the right thing. You ask people about him and you say, does he drink khamr? The people say, yes, that man drinks khamr. That man, he smokes weed. That man, he is cop. You're going to say, he can't marry my sister. And rightly so. Again, wallahi wa billahi wa tallahi, the one who doesn't pray, that's a bigger sin than drinking khamr. Not praying is a bigger sin than drinking khamr. And that's because the Nabi described the one who abandons salat, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as kufrun kafir. And the one who drinks khamr, he makes tawbah. He makes tawbah, he's not considered to be a non-Muslim. So what is it about? No doubt, don't get it wrong, drinking khamr is a kabair, is a major sin. No doubt about it. The Prophet said about khamr, al-khamr umul khaba'ir wa akbar kabair. It is the mother of all filthy things, and it's the biggest of the major sins. And yet, not praying is worse than that. Not praying is worse than that. So why is it that the community today, if the man wants to marry my daughter, my sister, he comes, I know he doesn't pray. No one in his family prays. I know him as a person who doesn't. That's not an issue that I consider. That's the difference between the companions and the people who get down. You want to know the way that the companions looked at the salah and the people today? Today, in this masjid, right now. Wallahu a'lam. I'm not putting anyone down. Allahu a'lam. Salatul Fajr today, the Prophet said about Salatul Fajr today, أفضل الصلاة Salatul Subh يوم الجمعة في الجماعة. The best prayer that you can make in the whole week, from Sunday to Saturday, the best prayer that you can make in the whole week is Salatul Fajr on Friday in Jama'ah. We look in the audience and the masjid is filled. Alhamdulillah, the masjid is filled. And the Salatul Fajr today is better than Salatul Fajr, better than Salatul Jum'ah. It's more virtuous and it's more important. It's the best salat during the course of the week. You'll find in this masjid today, people who didn't pray Salatul Fajr. I didn't say they prayed it late. People who don't pray Salatul Fajr, they just don't pray it. It's like that. So those companions back then, how did they look at the salat? The Nabi came out to them and he warned them about something that is serious. He warned them about the Dajjal. The biggest fitna that Allah created since Adam until Yawm al-Qiyamah. The most religious person here today, right now. If the Dajjal came, you can start to believe in him. May Allah protect us from that. So the Nabi used to teach his companions, إِذَا تَشَهَدَ أَحَدُكُمْ فِي صَلَاتِهِ فَلْيَسْتَعِنْ مِنْ أَرْبَعَ. If any of you come to the التَّهِيَاتُ لِلَّهِ وَالصَّلَوَاتُ الطَّيِّبَةِ, he said, if you come to that, then seek refuge in Allah from four things. And one of them was the fitna of al-Masih Dajjal in the salah. Whether it's the fajr, whether it's the wajib salah or the sunnah horn. And they want to say things like, al-khilafa, al-khilafa, al-Islam is the haqq al-Islam. All of that is kalam jameel and all of that is true. But where is the help of Allah for an individual, for a husband and a wife, for a family, for a community?
for a country, for an ummah, where is the help of Allah for people who don't pray? In tansurullah yansurkum wa yuthabbit aqdamakum. If you people help Allah, Allah help you, and He will establish your feet firmly. How do we help Allah? How? By doing what He said to do. By doing what He said to do. So the khutbah, ikhwani, is not about somebody here is bad and I'm better than you. The khutbah is about, number one, the level of those companions. And then we have a group of people today who come. You know this man, Umar, I just told you about. We have a group of people who come today and say, Abu Bakr and Umar were homosexuals. The wife of the Nabi, Aisha radiallahu anha, she used to commit zina. The Quran right there is not complete. How does Allah help a group of people who say that? How does Allah help a group of people? Me. I'm a regular, I don't say that, but the one who says it is my relative. And when I hear him say that, I think it's an easy thing for someone to talk about the companions of the Nabi. No one here would be a Muslim if it wasn't for Allah. Then for the sacrifices of those companions, radiallahu anhum ajma'in. As-salat, as-salat. أقول قولي هذا واستغفر الله لي ولكم ونسأل الله تعالى التوفيق والسداد. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله أما بعد. You want to know the importance of the salat with those companions رضي الله عنهم. A lot can be said, as I mentioned to you, but from what has to be mentioned is, as a Muslim, we have to believe from the names of Allah, as Allah is Al-Hakim. Al-Hakim, they translate it in English as being wise, and it does mean that, but there's a better meaning of Al-Hakim. Al-Hakim in this religion is the one who puts things in the proper place. وَدْرُوا شَيْفِ مَحَلِّهِ. If you an individual, who you know how to put things in the proper place, you're Hakim. The lady is Hakima. But if you don't know how to put things in the right place, you're not Hakim. Meaning what? If you don't know that your mother and your father have to be dealt with a particular way, then you're not Hakim. If you treat your mother as if she's the child and you're the parent, you're not Hakim. You didn't put that issue in the proper place. The Muslim, treating the Muslim like the kafir, and treating the kafir like he's a Muslim, you're not Hakim. Something's wrong. You didn't put it in the proper place. The Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was Hakim. Every decision he made, it was in the proper place. No one can come and say, Muhammad, he stole my money. Muhammad, before he became a Nabi, he did this. Muhammad, he was too rough, he was too tough. They can't do that. With the Muslims today, they can do that. They can say, you know, these guys, they want to establish Islam so they kill innocent people. That's not hikmah. That's janoon. That person is crazy. Gonna kill innocent people and say, Islam, jihad. The point is, Al-Hakim, from the names of Allah, Allah is Al-Hakim. He put everything in the right place. The halal of Islam is because Allah knew what to make halal. The haram, Allah knew. The amount of money that you have or you don't have, Allah knew. Allah could have given you the money that He gave Bill Gates, but Allah is Hakim. He knows who to give this and who to give that. The Muslim woman who says, oh, my husband's going to take another wife. Oh, I wish I could have two husbands. Hey lady, when Allah allowed the man to take two wives, there's hikmah in that. The man doing it the right way or the wrong way is a different issue. But Allah, the legislator, He's Al-Hakim. So what's the point about the hikmah of Allah? What did Allah Ta'ala, the question is, and I finish with this. What were the last words that came out of the mouth of the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam before he died? Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu, he told us. He said, when the Prophet was dying, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, how can Allah help a group of people who believe the Nabi never died? Ali ibn Abi Talib said, before the Prophet died, Allah said in the Quran, إِنَّكَ مَيِّتْ وَإِنَّهُمْ مَيِّتُونَ. Allah established these issues. Abu Bakr, after the death of the Nabi, he came and he saw him dead. He kissed him and he said, you taste and smell as sweet in death as you did in life. Then he came to the people and said, Anyone who worships Muhammad, Muhammad is dead. Anyone who worships Allah, Allah is a hay, not a yamut. And then the people say, no, he didn't die. How does Allah help a group of people like that? The Nabi, Ali ibn Abi Talib said, he was about to die. He had a bandage on his head, and he was going through a lot of pain to prepare him for the Maqam al-Mahmud in al-Jannah. So he has to get cleaned up, although he was already clean, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Ali said that the Nabi was unconscious. He opened his eyes. He said to the community, the last words he said, As-salat as-salat wa ma malakat al-manuku. He told Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, Ali, and the rest of them, the prayer, and take care of your right-hand possessions. Take care of your children, take care of your wives, take care of those under your authority, take care of your daughters. And then Ali said he lost consciousness. He said some time went by, the Prophet regained consciousness. The Nabi is Hakim. He could have said anything. What do you think he told the people? He could have said anything. Make dua to Allah to forgive everything. He could have said anything. He put it in the right place. What did he say? He said again, As-salat, as-salat, wa ma malakat aymanukum. Take care of the prayer, take care of the prayer, and what your right hands possess. He lost consciousness. He woke up a third time. After some time, what did he think he said? For emphasis, the third time, As-salat, as-salat, wa ma malakat aymanukum. Ummat al-Islam, take care of the salat, as-salat, and take care of what your right hands possess, and then he died, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Why do you think the Nabi would say that and make the last words that came out of his blessed mouth in this dunya were those words? And then the person comes and says, Allah is Ghafur Rahim, I don't have to pray. I pray when I want, how I want. I don't have to learn how to pray. It's the way I want to do it. The man came to the masjid and the Nabi was sitting, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The man prayed two rakats very quickly. He came and said, Salaamu alaykum ya Rasulullah. Rasulullah said, Wa alaykum salam wa rahmatullah, irja fa salli fa innaka lam tusalli. Go back and pray because you didn't pray. The man went back, he prayed two rakats very quickly, came back. Salaamu alaykum ya Rasulullah. Wa alaykum salam wa rahmatullah, irja fa salli fa innaka lam tusalli. Go back and pray, you didn't pray. The man did it. He's a Bedouin. The third time, very quickly, Salaamu alaykum Rasulullah. He told him, go back and pray, you didn't pray. The man said, that's all I know. The Nabi said, if you want to make salah, then make a good wudu. Face the Qibla. Read what's easy for you from the Quran. Then say Allahu Akbar. And then go into ruku and be in ruku with ease. And he went through the whole prayer. So what's the point? The person he prays, he's going to pray Fajr, but he didn't pray. Meaning he didn't pray correctly. He's eating riba. He's drinking khamr. He's not doing it for Allah. So many issues. So the message here, Ikhwani, we're finished with this. The message here, As-salat as-salat wa ma malakat aymanukum. Try to tighten up this issue with this prayer, because wallahi thumma billahi thumma tallahi, the one who doesn't pray, he doesn't have any Ramadan. No Ramadan. His Ramadan is batil by the Lord of the Kaaba. He has no Ramadan. No iman for the one who doesn't pray. May Allah Ta'ala help us to establish salat in our homes and in our hearts and in the land. May Allah Ta'ala make us of those people truthful in word and deed. May Allah Ta'ala forgive us for our indiscretions and our mistakes. And may Allah Ta'ala put us on the way and on the sirat of His companions of the Nabi, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Aqim as-salat, ya rahmatullah.
Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar.
Ikhwani, brothers and sisters, we want to make a proper prayer today. A prayer of discipline. Not the prayer of the culture, and not the prayer of the people who are busy. I told you Abdurrahman ibn Auf was behind the Nabi. Why? Because the people who used to be in the first row, they were the ones who would move according to the Nabi. If the Prophet put his head on the ground for sajda, that's when they put their heads on the ground. And then the people behind them saw them move. Not when the Nabi said Allah, the people started moving. They had discipline. When the Nabi put his head for sajda, these people in the first row, the umana, they will follow. And the people behind them paid attention. So it's not an easy thing just to pray in the first row right here. You have a responsibility. So the point is, before he used to pray, he used to tell the people, La tusabiquni, don't race me in the salah. He used to say, don't race me. So we want a salah of discipline. Everybody look to your right and your left. Put your heels equal with the person on your right and your left. And the lines will be straight. So, wa'tadidu, wa'la takhtarifu, fa'takhtarifa qulubukum wa'saddu al-khalal. Inna taswit al-saf min iqam al-salah. Mimu bayna aydi ikhwanikum. Allahu Akbar.
الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين بل عجبوا أن جاءهم منذر منهم فقال الكافرون هذا شيء عجيب أإذا متنا وكنا ترابا ذلك رجع بعيد قد علمنا ما تنقص الأرض منهم وعندنا كتاب حفيظ بل كذبوا بالحق لما جاءهم فهم في أمر مريد أفلم ينظروا إلى السماء فوقهم كيف بنيناها وزيناها وما لها من فروج والأرض مددناها وألقينا فيها رواسي وأنبتنا فيها من كل زوج بهيج تبصرة وذكرى لكل عبد منيب ونزلنا من السماء ماء مباركا فأنبتنا به جنات وحب الحصيد والنخل باسقات لها طلع نضيد رزقا للعباد وأحيينا به بلدة ميتا كذلك الخروج كذبت قبلهم قوم نوح وأصحاب رس وثمود وعاد وفرعون وإخوان لوط وأصحاب الأيكة وقوم تبع كل كذب الرسل فحق وعيد أفعينا بالخلق الأول بل هم في لبس من خلق جديد الله أكبر سمع الله لمن حمده الله أكبر الله أكبر
Describe the one who abandons Salah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as kufr and kafir, and the one who drinks khamr, he makes tawbah. He makes tawbah, he's not considered to be a non-Muslim. So what is it about? No doubt, don't get it wrong, drinking khamr is a kaba'ir, is a major sin. No doubt about it. The Prophet said about khamr, al-khamr umul khaba'ir, wa akbar kaba'ir. It is the mother of all filthy things, it is the biggest of the major sins. And yet, not praying is worse than that. Not praying is worse than that. So why is it that the community today, if the man wants to marry my daughter, my sister, he comes, I know he doesn't pray. No one in his family prays. I know him as a person doesn't. That's not an issue that I consider. That's the difference between the companions and the people who get down. You want to know the way that the companions looked at the salah and the people today? Today, in this masjid, right now. Wallahu a'lam. I'm not putting anyone down. Allahu a'lam. Salat al-Fajr today, the Prophet said about Salat al-Fajr today. Afdal as-salat, Salat al-Subh, Yawm al-Jum'ah, Fil Jama'ah. The best prayer that you can make in the whole week, from Sunday to Saturday, the best prayer that you can make in the whole week is Salat al-Fajr on Friday in Jama'ah. We look at the audience and the masjid is filled. Alhamdulillah, the masjid is filled. And the Salat al-Fajr today is better than Salat al-Fajr, better than Salat al-Jum'ah. It's more virtuous and it's more important. It's the best salat during the course of the week. You'll find in this masjid today, people who didn't pray Salat al-Fajr. I didn't say they prayed it late. People who don't pray Salat al-Fajr, they just don't pray it. It's like that. So those companions back then, how did they look at the salat? The Nabi came out to them and he warned them about something that is serious. He warned them about the Dajjal. The biggest fitna that Allah created since Adam until Yawm al-Qiyamah. The most religious person here today, right now. If the Dajjal came, you can start to believe in him. May Allah protect us from that. So the Nabi used to teach his companions, إِذَا تَشَهَدَ أَحَدُكُمْ فِي صَلَاتِهِ فَلْيَسْتَعِذْ بِمِنْ أَرْبَعْ. If any of you come to the التَّهِيَاتُ لِلَّهِ وَالصَّلَوَاتُ الطَّيِّبَاتُ, he said, if you come to that, then seek refuge in Allah from four things. And one of them was the fitna of al-Masih Dajjal in the salah. Whether it's the fajr, whether it's the wajib salah or the sunnah prayer. Why did he tell us to seek refuge in Allah from these four things concerning, and it was in the salah? Because it's important, it can protect it. But that's not the point I want to make about Dajjal. The Nabi, he came out, he told his companions, when the Dajjal comes, he's going to be on this earth for 40 days, 40. Making fitna and fasad. And the fitna that we see in the earth today is a cake walk in the park. It's just a walk in the park compared to the fitna of a Dajjal. The Nabi said, in those 40 days, 40, he said the first day is going to be like a year. The second day is going to be like a month. The third day is going to be like a week. And the subsequent 27 days are going to be like the days that we have. 37 days are like the days we have. Now, if the Muslims heard that hadith for the first time from the Nabi, people are going to say, how does Allah protract the time? How does Allah extend the time? How? Although Allah can do anything. When Allah talked about himself, what he does, what he doesn't do, where he is, there are those Muslims who say, how, why, when? And it's not for him to ask how, why, when. It's just for him to make istisna, to submit. When those companions heard that the job, 40 days, first day like a year, second day like a month, third day like a week, and the rest of the days like the regular days, the very first question the companions said was, Ya Rasulullah, kayfa nusalli? Ya Rasulullah, how do we pray? If one day is like a year, how do we pray? If one day is like a month, how do we pray Fajr, Dhuhr, Asr, Maghrib, Isha? How? The Nabi told them, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, قَدِّرُهَا تَقْدِيرًا. Try your best to figure out the time of the prayer. Try your best. So the shahid and the point of that hadith is, the Muslims during that time, the companion, part of who he was, the part of who he is I have to pray. So when I hear this story about Dajjal, the most important thing to those people was, how do I make my salat during that time? Again, if the people heard it today, If the people heard it today for the first time, at Dajjal, 40 days, 1 year, 1 month, 1 week, the people are going to say today, I hope that Dajjal comes out. When he comes, I hope that first day, the World Cup, the people in the World Cup, so that it'll be a whole year. I hope it's doing the time he comes in the first day, the second day. I hope it's doing the time when I'm in my vacation, the holidays. But the companions, they were not on that. The companions, their issue was the Salat is a part of the identity of the Muslim in al-Islam. Umar radiallahu anhu. You want to know the Salat with those companions? During the death and the ultimate assassination of Umar radiallahu anhu. He had a problem with a non-Muslim who lived under his just authority. The non-Muslim said, I'm going to kill him. And he had to figure out what's the best time to kill him. He was not going to meet Umar, who was a man. He wasn't going to meet him face to face in the street and say what he has to say. He was a coward, and he did what the cowards do. Cowards, they talk behind your back. Cowards, they always have to get you when you're unawares. As for the man, stand off in the man's face and tell him what the situation. He couldn't do that. He said, I'm going to wait until he starts praying. Umar radiallahu anhu came to Salatul Fajr and he started praying Salatul Fajr. While he was praying, that man knew once those companions start to pray, they don't look around. Those companions not preoccupied with other stuff. They don't go into their pockets. Their mobile phones won't go off. You will never be able to pray a prayer in the messages of the Muslims without the mobile phone going off. Those companions were far away from anything that would distract someone from the Salat. So the man knew that. Umar was praying. The man came and cut him in his stomach. And it didn't stop there. On the way out of the masjid, he was stabbing other people in the first row. He killed 14 people in the first row. 14 people. What do you think happened? When Umar was stabbed, Umar didn't say, Salaam alaikum rahmatullah. Umar just grabbed Abdurrahman ibn Auf, who was from the ulama of the companions. During the time of the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it was the scholars of the companions who used to pray right behind the Nabi. And I'm going to tell you why later about that, inshallah. Umar was stabbed. He turned around. He took Abdurrahman ibn Auf, one of the 10 people promised Jannah. He went up and he shortened the prayer. He finished the prayer. The people came and took care of the people who were hurt and killed. Now, if the imam today, something happened in the masjid, the imam caught a heart attack, something happened, and he stopped praying. And we called the EMS, Emergency Medical Services. Nobody can blame us for calling them, for stopping praying. We'll make the prayer in a few minutes. But those companions were not like that. The man was sad. They continued to pray. He shortened the prayer, Abdurrahman bin Auf, and they took Umar to his house, and they took the other people. It doesn't stop there. The people knew in the 12, 13 years of the Khilafah of Umar, al-Islam spread. It was the golden years of Islam. They found it hard to fathom the man is going to die. They thought he was going to live. They gave him some milk. He drank the milk. It came out of his intestines. They said, this man is going to die. Don't let him sleep, because if he goes to sleep, he won't wake up. So they tried to keep him awake. Umar fell asleep. Abdullah bin Abbas, he said, I know what will wake him up. They were trying to wake him up. He wouldn't wake up. He said, I know what will wake him up. He said, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, waqt al-Salat. It's time for Salat. Umar woke up. And he said to the Muslims, in an authentic statement of Umar radiallahu anhu, Wallahi la imana liman la salat alahu. I swear by Allah, Umar said, there is no iman for the one who doesn't pray. He's not a mu'min. His Islam is suspect. He has 1 foot in kufr and 1 foot in Islam. The one who's negligent about his prayer. There are those people who consider themselves Muslims. They only pray their Eid. There are those who consider themselves Muslims. They only pray Jummah. There are those who consider themselves Muslims. They only pray if other people pray. The Shabab of the Muslims, the Shabab, our children, 16, 15, 14, they're in school, they don't pray. In the university, don't pray. The Nabi said, showing the importance of this Salah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, أَيُّمَا رَجُلٍ مِّنْ أُمَّتِي أَدْرَكَتُ الصَّلَاةِ فَلْيُصَلِّي. Any man from this ummah, if the time for Salah comes, he has to pray. There is no condition that can face the Muslim when he doesn't pray. If he is paralyzed on his back, but he has his faculties, he has to pray on his back. If he's traveling, he has to pray. The other arkan of Islam, four arkan of Islam of actions, salah, zakat, soul, and hajj. Those other three, zakat, soul, hajj, they are predicated upon your ability. If you don't have the ability, you don't have to do zakat. You don't have the ability, you don't have to fast. You're traveling, you don't have to fast. You don't have the ability, you don't have to have make hajj. The lady is rich, she has £2 million to her name. £2 million. She doesn't have to make hajj unless she has a mahram. But that salah, salah, you have to make salah no matter what your situation is. No matter what your situation is. The Muslim has to make the salah. It's the only rukn from the arkan that the Nabi took from Allah directly in the Isra wa Mi'raj. Every other rukn from the arkan, zakat, soul, hajj, Jibreel came and said, Ya Muhammad, tell your companions they have to give zakat. They have to fast. They have to make hajj. For the salah, Allah Azza wa Jal took the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the Isra wa Mi'raj and he made the salah wajib. And when the Nabi met Musa in the Jannah, after taking his prayer and he came back, Musa said, how many salahs did your Lord make incumbent upon the people? The Nabi told him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam 100. He said, go back because they won't be able to do it. All the way till it came down, all the way till it came down to what we have right now. And it's going to equal 50 if the person does the five prayers. 50. Musa said, go back. These five that they have to make, they won't be able to do it. Sadaqa Musa. My wife, she stays in the bed for Fajr. My wife, she prays without proper hijab. My son, 16 years old, prays without wudu. That's the condition of the Muslim. So, ikhwani, some people want to take the microphone, they want to take the bullhorn, and they want to say things like, Al-Khilafa, Al-Islam is the haqq, Al-Islam. All of that is kalam jameel, and all of that is true. But where is the help of Allah for an individual, for a husband and a wife, for a family, for a community, for a country, for an ummah? Where is the help of Allah for people who don't pray? In tansurullah yansurkum wa yuthabbit aqdamakum. If you people help Allah, Allah help you, and they will establish your feet firmly. How do we help Allah? How? By doing what He said to do. By doing what He said to do. So the khutbah, ikhwani, is not about somebody here is bad and I'm better than you. The khutbah is about, number one, the level of those companions. And then we have a group of people today who come. You know this man, Umar just told you about. We have a group of people who come today and say, Abu Bakr and Umar were homosexuals. The wife of the Nabi, Aisha radiallahu anha, she used to commit zina. The Quran right there is not complete. How does Allah help a group of people who say that? How does Allah help a group of people? Me. I don't say that. But the one who says it is my relative. And when I hear him say that, I think it's an easy thing for someone to talk about the companions of the Nabi. No one here would be a Muslim if it wasn't for Allah. Then for the sacrifices of those companions, radiallahu anhum ajma'in. As-salat, as-salat. Aqulu qawli hadha wa astaghfirullah li wa lakum wa nas'alullah ta'ala tawfiq wa sadaq. Alhamdulillah, wassalatu wassalam ala rasulillahi amma ba'du.